Welcome to 1 Minute CM. We have Shekhar Vijayan from Bangalore joining in today. A quick note about Shekhar. He's a weight transformation coach. He's a life coach. He's an entertainer, which is very difficult. It's difficult to entertain people nowadays. He's an author, actor, speaker, comedian, and he's also an RJ. He's done 1,000+ events since 2014, and which comprise of sports activities for brands like Decathlon. You know, he's done book launches, rock shows, product launches, corporate gigs, you know, and a lot of marketing activities and the events around it. The best thing about Shekhar is he's one example where he's reduced from 125 kilos to 80 kilos, which is 46 inches to 32 inches. In a year without going to the gym. So we are glad to have you here. I mean, we love coaches, but you know, we don't have coaches who are themselves a live example of weight reduction. And you've been an entertainer. I'm really new to this, Shekhar. So I have somebody who's here for almost a decade. So thanks for joining in. Maybe you can give a quick introduction to our new friends and you know, make some new good connections today.
Yeah, thank you so much, Ravi. I think it goes without saying, the world we are living in right now, we can all do with a lot of positivity, with a lot of smiles and a lot of 1 minutes as a CM or as a PM or as a president. But I think more than anything else, I think it's about making the most of what you have and maximizing it. And in my case, I would say that there are two things I'm good at. I can instill confidence in anyone, and I can write also. I have that energy in me, which I'm very much aware of. And somewhere in this world, I believe, you know, there's so much of information which is bombarding us as we talk. And there's a lot of positive news, a lot of negative news, and how you stay positive. And you can stay positive by setting an inspiration for others by just being yourself, which a lot of people are not able to do because so many filters in the world and there's an image you're living up to. But if you're honest, and true to yourself, it doesn't take much time. You don't need to lie. And when you don't need to lie, you don't need to think so much. You just, what you are is what you see, right? It's like a mirror. And I genuinely believe, I think the world will be a better place if we all are honest to ourselves, because that's what makes the world special. And you look at any creative artist, you look at any leader around us, if they're able to articulate about what they have in their head, right down to the lowest common denominator, that makes a lot of difference. Something
cool. So how was the journey of, you know, this weight transformation? So did you put on any weight, extra weight during this pandemic, because there was not much of activities around?
So I think I can hold a certificate course in doing jhadu poncha in washing the plates. I still fail to understand, even after they, like, my in-laws were in town, my mom was in town like a few days back, so you understand the plates are more, and you know, yeah, but now just two of us, me and my wife and my dog. And the plates just keep increasing. It's like, you know, you're like, itna kya khate hum log? So you're using one spoon for multiple things. But on a more serious note, I think I can do a certificate course in jhadu poncha. I can qualify for that. And I know the blind spots in the house, like they say, where more dust would accumulate. And we've just shifted into a new house right here in Brigade. This is a Brigade property. It's a 3-bedroom house. So it almost feels like a guest house, because earlier, you know, as soon as we shifted, we had 100 people who would come in from Kerala and Chennai, because my wife is from Chennai. And just 2 days before the lockdown, everybody went back home. And then my mom and my in-laws were here for the 3 months. And my mom left last week. My in-laws drove down to Coimbatore where they stay. Now it's like just two of us, three of us. Suddenly the house has become bigger because, you know, there are only two people in the house, right?
Yeah.
And there are more places to clean now. So it's good. It's an activity. And I think one way to get through this lockdown is to make a schedule about what we want to do in the whole day. Because they say an idle mind is devil's workshop, right? So there's various ways of just losing it completely and saying that, oh my God, how could this happen to us? How could this happen to the world? But the only way to deal with this right now is to just build a schedule and work as per it. And I think somewhere in this lockdown, I've learned some new skills. I've learned how to play the guitar. I have also learned, obviously, I also do a plank every half an hour. So, you know, if I'm on a virtual meeting or a virtual call, I can do a plank every half an hour, every, so that's an advantage of what I do, because, and I've made people do planks at various events, which I do. So somebody challenges me to a plank, I'm game for it. So from the likes of Virat Kohli to anyone, anybody who's really fit, and Mandira Bedi. Mandira Bedi very recently had posted a book launch just before the lockdown. And she challenged me to a plank. And we did a plank just before the launch happened. So it was very interesting. I usually tell them, and here somebody's challenging me. So we did a plank and we gave a high five to each other. And that's somewhere where, and I also do I read a lot. Irrespective of the lockdown, I'm a voracious reader. But I've been reading The Art of War which is very interesting to understand the Chinese strategy. And this is something like The Art of War, what is happening right now around us. It's a pandemic of epic proportions. And the only way to deal with it is to understand it's a pandemic and to ride the storm, because I think we have dealt with bigger storms in our lives. So this is nothing new. But the only way to deal with it is to stand in it together and sail in it together, I believe, and conquer it together.
What have been your biggest achievements so far?
In during the pandemic or before the pandemic? Before the pandemic. So I've done shows with... So essentially, I started entertaining, engaging, motivating, and inspiring people. I used to do this when I was working in my company. I was working in companies like Accenture. Before that, I was working in Dell, Convergys, HP. And I realized I'm very good with engaging with people. As in, I'm the kind of guy, if somebody wants to leave the job today, I can convince that person to stay in the company for the next whole year. I could do that because I could make that person believe in themselves. I was almost like Coach Carter. I was somebody who could inspire people. And it worked very well for me when I was working in the corporate sector, because attrition is so big, huge, right? And I worked at a call center, and especially in a call center in the outsourcing space, you're dealing with the millennials of the world who get a lot of money and they don't know what to do with it because lack of mentors, which is a case right now also as we talk. I think in the corporate circle, it's very important to have the right mentor around you and also have positivity around you, because when you have so much of money, you don't know what to do with it. A lot of people use it for various reasons. So I set an example there because I was working in companies like Convergys, Dell, HP, Accenture. And, I used to motivate and inspire people. But I didn't realize I could go out and entertain also. I didn't realize that. And I was not somebody who was doing this in school or college or even in a family atmosphere. I was the last person to even play housey, for example. But this suddenly out of the blue, after I left, at one point of time, I just thought, I'm working for a mid-year review. And I didn't want that to happen. And when I came and told my wife is the biggest stakeholder here, and I told her that I want to leave my job. She said, what's your backup plan? I said, I don't have a backup plan, but I want to write my GMAT. I gave my GMAT. I got a score of 720. And I was supposed to travel to INSEAD Singapore to join the place. But I ended up joining a radio station. I became a radio jock, and where I went out and interacted with a live audience. And I love the energy of, like what we're doing right now in terms of interacting, energizing, and talking to people. I love that because I think everybody is a story, and everybody wants a story to be heard. There is a lot of information even in the silence, which I believe. And somehow I was able to tap that because I'm a very attentive listener, and I can say humor in a lot of things, and humor is, I think, somewhere the best way to diffuse any situation, be it negative or positive, I believe. Because people don't know how to use it. Some of them make it sound very condescending or very sardonic. They don't know what really humor is. So humor is essentially how you look at it and how you are also self-deprecating about yourself, because people don't like... I think in today's day and age, it's all about ego. Everybody wants to have the last word in anything. If you look at your Facebook chats, WhatsApp chats, Instagram, everybody wants to be an expert in everything and they want to have the last word. And because we're living in a very polarizing world, opinions are very polarized, people want to have the last word. So somewhere I think, that ego should be shed aside. And I realized it very early in the game that the only way to get to be good at what, and I always believe that you don't win the silver, you lose the gold. I believe in that a lot. I believe you got to be the best in what you do. And the only way to be the best in what you do is consider yourself as your own competition. Don't look at anybody else. And somewhere I realized that very early and I worked towards it, wherein I've done events, 4 to 5 events in a day. And I've come back energized and not slept the whole night and just got up the next morning. That it's that high of doing an event, which is almost like a drug, where you're energizing, interacting, and motivating people. You live for that, you love for that. And that kind of love I never got when I was working. somehow. I don't know. I just, like, as I'm talking to you right now, I totally enjoy this moment. I enjoy this moment at 11:13 in the morning. So if I have to look at it and say, what is the reason for my success? I think somewhere it's because I was completely honest to it. And there's a lot of love for it, as simple as that. And I've done events as interesting and as versatile as holding a marathon for dogs. You'll be very surprised. And doing hula hoop sessions with dogs, where dogs, musical chairs, where dogs actually know when the music stops. So wow. When you work with such interesting stakeholders who don't have a bad hair day at all, you're like, wow, this is really interesting. I would love to do this forever. So, and you know, then I'd done events with people as charismatic as Jeffrey Archer, with somebody as pleasant as you, for example. And I think Jeffrey Archer is extremely charismatic. He's been writing stories for the last 70 years, 60 years. And, you know, I've done his book launch twice in Bangalore. And when you do it something like that, and there are people who have come in and, you know, the energy is palpable because everybody wants to have a piece of him. And you got to entertain them before he comes on board. So you involve them using a quiz, you ask them questions, and you make sure that you're very well prepared also. So there's a lot of preparation which goes into it. But more than anything, it's also all about presence of mind and being very spontaneous and just understanding the world around you. So I think somewhere I enjoy watching, listening, and observing people. Because I, like I tell you, there's like the wonderful Buddha behind you, I think it's all about the peace around us, the calmness around us, and what we can get out of it. That's what I believe.
Good. Shekhar, can you talk about this particular picture?
Oh, yes. The people at Printo, where I got this printed, were blown. They were like, wow, we've got a masterpiece. Literally, figuratively and metaphorically. So the one on the left side is me. I was 125 kilos a year back, and I was 46 inches on the waist. And this was taken somewhere in, I think, Wayanad in Kerala, in one of those tea estates. The one on the right is, again, yours truly. And this was taken at a 10-year celebration of my marriage. So everybody came in and had a good time. This was in one of the clubs in Chennai. Now, this was, one on the left is 46 inches on the waist, 125 kilos. The one on the right is 32 inches on the waist. And fitting into clothes, which I used to wear 15 years back, 20 years back. So it's obviously, and it's only happened purely because of, I use this word a lot, because of being stubborn. And stubborn is not a negative word for me, because I believe when you stay stubborn, you also stay strong. And I didn't follow the norm of going to the gym, because I didn't want to waste money going to the gym. And you know, like, everybody goes on the 1st of Jan and pays a lot of money to the gym and the gym instructor, and then, you know, that entire wave of doing working out for the first week is there, and then after 1 week, everything just recedes. I didn't want to get into that zone. So somewhere, I think one day when I was watching an India-Pakistan game, I was sitting on a chair and the plastic chair fell off, broke. And right behind me was a glass dining table. And that's when it hit me hard that, you know, next time my head might just hit it. So in the case of anybody who's fat or overweight, it doesn't hit you hard until it hits you hard. When I'm saying that, the whole world might tell you you're fat, but you don't work on it until it hits you personally. And that's what it is. And once it starts hitting you personally, you're stubborn. You go against all odds to prove not them wrong, to prove you're right. And that can only happen. And in my case, I started first walking for 2 kilometers with my dog. My dog didn't want a six pack, of course. So she was happy. And then I started walking for 4 kilometers, 6 kilometers. I managed to do 5 kilometers in 30 minutes walking, that is. Then I started running, and I enjoyed the process of running because I could do 10 kilometers in 38 to 40 minutes, which is very good as a marathoner. And I really love the energy of running, because there's a certain rhythm to running. You know, when your left leg, right leg, and everything moves in sync, it's something which is very magical. And if you ask any marathoner, they will explain to you in a better way. It's almost like an artist. And I also make sure that I don't eat anything in a packet. So basically, that means your murukku, your fried items, anything in a packet is totally out. I don't drink, I don't smoke. I was not doing that earlier too. So that's a big advantage. When you don't drink and you don't smoke, you don't eat much. And your health is good. And I also do a plank every half an hour, like I said. So that plank is for 2 minutes every half an hour from the time I wake up. So if I wake up at 5 in the morning, till say around 11 in the night, I've done a plank every half an hour. So that keeps me fit in terms of my core. And I also eat lots of fruits. I avoid red meat. I avoid rice. I don't have milk. I don't have coffee. I don't have tea. I have green tea, no doubt. Then I don't. I have avoided salt and sugar and anything white completely. So there's no salt, no sugar, nothing white in my diet at all. But I have a lot of fruits. I have a lot of watermelons. I have muskmelon. I avoid pineapples because pineapple has got a lot of sugar. I hate mangoes. So mango is the king of fruits, and there are a lot of people who love. a lot of people who love mangoes, but somehow I feel mango is overrated as a fruit. I think the likes of watermelon should get a key in somewhere. So if I'm a chief minister, I would want to have more watermelons. Yeah, but drink lots of water. I think water is something which is very underrated. We should drink as much water as we can, and have lots of vegetables, because vegetables are the best way to actually lose weight. And avoid red meat as much as you can. Avoid rice. So for all the biryani eaters out there, I would suggest just stop eating biryani. Have the pieces if you can. And it's not easy to maintain this discipline, because initially when you're doing it, you know, your body gives you different messages, your mind gives you different messages. And it's a 21-day routine which you have. They say 21 days it takes for you to get a habit or to negate that habit. And I think that's what Mr. Modi also did with your lockdown, I believe. He always wanted Indians to be in lockdown for 3 months. He's broken down into three particular parameters. And somewhere it makes sense, because 21 days is what it takes to make a habit and create a habit. And somewhere it becomes your state of mind, your discipline. And I'm telling you, our mind is so very sharp. You won't believe it. Like, there are days when I've just gone without tea or coffee and I've managed it pretty well. And if it's raining outside, I also use the stairs. So I was staying in the 11th floor earlier. Now I'm staying in the 6th floor. I do 45 minutes of that in the morning, 45 minutes of that in the night, which is almost like 15 kilometers. And best way to stay fit is to actually use the stairs instead of the elevator. So it's also like the life journey. Instead of using the elevator, which might stop at some point and electricity is not there, you don't want to get stuck in a limbo. It's better to use the stairs, because nobody uses the stairs, one. So chances of infection is less. You also know, you can also see how you look in terms of the windows. And it's a great feeling when you're going up the stairs to the 6th floor, when you're sweating, and it's basically you're doing. And I also use this ankle length pads, which are these 1 kilo pads which I use to put more strength on the legs. So that makes a lot of difference. Overall, your body's, the stamina is there, and it keeps you going for a longer time.
We have questions from Nakul Gupta. He's asking which sport application you use.
Would really like to follow you. Nakul Saab, I don't use any sports application. There are a couple of, not really actually. I'm there on Facebook, and I put out videos on Instagram and YouTube. So I don't use any sports application as such. Like I told you, it's very simple what I do, but somehow I've achieved success. I think somewhere your body also reacts to it in a certain way. And I think our body is also used to a certain way of living. And I also realized this, sir, I think the main thing is loving your body and respecting your body, because your body is going to be your best friend till you die. Nobody else is going to matter. So you've got to respect it and love it as much as we can. And now, you know, people are a little scared. Immunity is important, and staying indoors is important. Do your yoga, do your pranayams, do your planks, do whatever builds up your immunity. And I think it's also important to build positivity around you, to build that entire bubble of people around you or things around you which can make you stay fit and stay active. I think fitness is a state of mind. I've always believed that it's not something which is physical, it's mental. It's just making sure that you're disciplined, you follow a plan, of course, and you enjoy what you do. So even if you're having lots of vegetables, even if you're having lots of water, relish that moment. Don't feel bad that you're missing out on something in life.
Cool. We have another picture for you.
Oh, yes.
Yeah,
so that's my mom. She looks very graceful in a sari. And this is my dog. Her name is Sunshine. And this was at Cubbon Park in Bangalore, which I think is one of the... Bangalore has some very, very interesting parks. There's a lot of greenery in Bangalore, and Bangalore is very cosmopolitan by nature. So I was born and brought up in Delhi, and I've been in Bangalore for the last 20 years. And the one thing which I, they're not just one thing, there are numerous things to like about Bangalore, is the cosmopolitan nature for one. The climate is, like I told you earlier, I think it's beautiful. You never know whether it's morning, evening or night, because anytime there can be a downpour. And this place where we are right now is Cubburn Park, which is right opposite Chinnaswamy Stadium. And it's one of the fresher parts of Bangalore. You've got people doing anything and everything there. There are laughter sessions which happen. There are dog parks here. And there are people just looking at the leaves and just being happy. And it's a wonderful moment to go outdoors and just to see what's going on there. So that's my mom. We have the same smiles and hopefully the same kind of hairstyle also. And yeah, that's my dog. Her name is Sunshine. I think she's an inspiration. Not because she's my dog, but because of the fact that I think animals, if you spend some time with them, you realize that they just live in the moment. They're just enjoying that moment. They have nothing else to worry about. And they're just living in that moment. So I think that's something which I try to follow, living this moment, not the past or the future, because we can't get out of this alive. So make the most of it and let's see what happens next. But this moment is the most important moment. So when you focus on this moment, you give your best always. That's what I believe, because you don't win the silver, you lose the gold.
So Shekhar, let's quickly get into rapid fire questions because we want to know you well. And
surely.
Let's see how you respond to some of these questions.
Yeah.
If you had to buy something for your girlfriend today during this special lockdown, what would you go and buy out in the market?
A vaccine for COVID-19.
Okay.
That'd be like a lifesaver. But for my wife. So my girlfriend is my wife. If my wife is watching this, hi, Misha. Yeah.
Okay. So what was your last dream you remember?
Last dream. I felt that 2020 was going to be the year when there'll be flying saucers and we'll be talking to animals. But here, animals are talking to us and there's nothing like flying saucers. The only saucers I see right now are saucers inside the house. So, yeah. I'm a big fan of Back to the Future, the movie Back to the Future. And I think it's very, very relevant right now as we talk about how the situation is.
Yeah, we watched that during the pandemic. The most embarrassing workshop or event which you conducted and, you know, something which was like unplanned, very embarrassing moment.
So there was an event I did with Harbhajan Singh. This was for hospital. And I asked Harbhajan Singh, how did it feel to slap Srishant? This is the time when he had the slap kid controversy happened. And I just asked him off the cuff and I knew that he was going to give an answer about it, but he just sipped a cup of coffee and he just kept quiet. Also, once I had met Rahul Dravid at his house in Bangalore. And this is when I was staying right behind his house in Indranagar. And, you know, so obviously you're big fans and you've just shifted to Bangalore. And and Rahul Dravid was just prepping up for a Bangladesh tour. So I had gone to his house. His mother invited us inside. We had tea and biscuits and everything. And Rahul Dravid comes and I asked him, the first question I asked him, how does it feel to be on the other side when Sachin Tendulkar is batting? So it was obviously not the right question to ask. I hope he was not thinking of 194, the declaration. But that is very embarrassing. And quickly, I changed the topic and then moved on to something else. But yeah, other than that, I think more than embarrassing situation, it's about how you diffuse the situation quickly.
Your most or least favorite food?
Least favorite food? I hate anything made out of butter, cheese, milk, and ghee. I think they should be banned from this world. Because
You should try keto once.
I should try keto once, yeah. But my least favorite food
is... All I'm eating is this list of items that you mentioned.
Yeah, and I hate bengan. I don't know how somebody can have bengan which is burnt. So I don't like that vegetable at all. Otherwise, I like most of the vegetables. I'm fine.
Best compliments ever?
Best compliments ever? My mother-in-law thinks I'm a licensed officer. So I don't know whether that's a compliment or not. She still doesn't know what I do, which is good. So it'll take a lifetime to figure out. But a lot of people have told me that I have the ability to energize them and motivate them, which is very nice. And I think it's a beautiful feeling. And that my hairstyle is like Jesus Christ because I was born on Christmas Day.
See, making others laugh is very tough. So, you know, toughest situation where, you know, you're there on the stage and, you know, you're trying to crack a joke, but no response.
So this happened at the first moment. I performed at an event for a very popular ice cream giant, stand-up comedy. This was the first time I'm doing it for half an hour, 30 minutes. 30 minutes is no joke because when you're talking about 30 minutes, you have to write for at least 2 days as a material. and you don't know what will bomb, what will not work. And this is the first time you're doing it. So my mom also wanted to be there. So my mom is sitting in the front row and I am performing comedy. And as usual, you know, we started off and the jokes bombed. So when your jokes bomb, what you end up doing is you use the easier route. You start cracking sex jokes or below the belt jokes. Usually that makes people laugh. So it was very embarrassing for me to do that because my mom is sitting there watching me and I'm the blue-eyed boy in the house and suddenly things don't turn out to be as blue as expected. But I had to get the laughs. So it was very embarrassing for me. And I told my mom, next time you're not coming for any of my comedy shows. So yeah, but that's how I managed it.
Did you ever fall from a tree?
I ever fall from a tree? I've fallen from a motorbike. I had a bullet, the old red and black and gold bullet, which I think has got the most beautiful sound, which I think a lot of people have fallen in love with the sound more than the bike. And I had once tried to avoid an accident and I fell off the bike and the bike fell on me. And this was when I was 130 kilos, 125 kilos. And life turned upside down after that. I had a fracture on my hand and I was in hospital for 2 months. And that's when, you know, it teaches you a lot that I was more concerned about the bike, whether the bike was in perfect shape. And then I think within a day or two, my wife sold it without blinking an eyelid. And I've never forgiven her for that even now. But then things happen and she told me you're not driving a bike again. So yeah, that's something which was a moment to think about in terms of falling. If not from a tree, but from a bike.
Few celebrity with which you had very good selfie moments.
Mandira Bedi is one. Jeffrey Archer, Virat Kohli, Pat Cummins. He's the guy who, if IPL had been played right now, he was the highest paid player. Now, unfortunately, schooling his heels in Australia. So I done a show with him in Australia for the Indian community, where he was at that time he was a part of KKR, Kolkata Knight Riders. And you know, I told him Shah Rukh Khan is a big draw all around the world. And can you show some Shah Rukh Khan moves? So I showed him some typically desi steps and he had to follow that. So he really enjoyed it. For any foreigner, they do one, two steps like a tubelet, they feel happy, which is very Indian for all of us because we can dance in any situation. Then also, I think I performed at a place where Michael Jackson had performed in Australia. And that was beautiful for me because Michael Jackson for me has always been the total entertainer because he could entertain you. He could read, he could write his music. His music, if you look at his music right now, it's so relevant in what's happening around the world. And I think his music has always been relevant and he's a superlative performer. So to perform at the same place as Michael Jackson performed, I think that's a big high. But so selfie moments could be like this Virat Kohli, of course, because he's quite a big draw right now. And we had a very interesting talk around my Fat to Fit moment. And both are from Delhi, of course, so the Delhi connection is there. But then I think more than selfie, I think you get to meet so many interesting people along the way. And you stay. I also have done a lot of shows with Kiran Mazumdar Shaw. Mm-hmm. I met her when I was traveling from London back to India. And we had a long discussion. Shashi Tharoor, of course, Sudha Murthy. Sudha Murthy, I feel simplicity is her biggest skill. And then you have got Shashi Tharoor, who has written a dictionary of his own, I believe. But Sudha Murthy is simplicity. I cannot even pin down to who all I've met because I've met n number of people and I've had some very, very interesting conversations. Mahesh Bhatt, I met. We had some very interesting conversations around movies and over a cup of coffee. Shashi Tharoor, Mahesh Bhatt, Sudha Murthy, lot of people. Harbhajan Singh, Milka Singh. Milka Singh was very interesting because Milka Singh has lost, I think, lost only 4 medals in his life. So supposedly out of 80 races he participated, he won 76 times.
Wow.
And I was like, wow. And this is at a time when there was no sponsorship. There was nothing for them. And he was just a man who had come in from Pakistan to India and started running, right? He had a very, very, very traumatizing childhood. And when you meet such people, you realize that, you know, these people are like, they're really so focused about what they want. He's lost only 4 times because he looked back or he didn't have the right coaching to how to handle it. So winning 76 out of 80 times is itself a big deal. And yeah, so that's a conversation I remember with P.T. Usha, for example. Mohanlal, I did a show with him in Cochin. And it was very simple. We had lunch together. Very evolved, I would say. and very interesting to talk to also. And also because he's a Malayali and I'm a Malayali, so a lot of movies I've grown up on in which he's acted in, and I think he's a complete actor. So a lot of people.
You're a morning person or a night owl?
I can stay awake till 2:33 in the night, and I can wake up by 7 in the morning. I just need 4 to 5 hours of sleep. That's all. I love it when nightfall happens. I love it. I feel that there's a new day coming in. So I enjoy that moment. But I cannot, I'm not much of a sleeper. I don't want to miss out on what's going on in the world.
So it's Friday, and you know, we're almost close to the weekend, so which we're not realizing. So you mentioned that you don't drink, but you know, one of the questions I had was, there are at least 5 to 6 characters when group of friends booze, each of them enact differently. So can you enact 5 different characters or people when they join together and booze?
So 5 to 6 different characters. So you would be quite surprised.
Common
behavior. So my weekends are spent in with my dog, and we have these very interesting conversations. Somehow. I'm not the kind of guy who would go out on a party with 5 to 6 characters, but from what I've observed, there'll always be one person who will obviously get the drinks. There will always be one person who will make sure that eats are fine. And there'll always be one person who will be a teetotaler in this entire group. And everybody will make fun of the teetotaler, saying, boss, tum to kuch peete nahi ho, tum bas soda mein khush ho jate ho. And believe it or not, the person who is the teetotaler, he'll be the person who's the highest, who's high at that moment. So it's quite ironical from what I've observed. But my weekends ideally are just very, very intuitive, where I spend time with my dog, go for long walks, go for long runs with her, spend a lot of time with nature actually. There's a lake right outside my house, and I've just gone out to see how it is in the early mornings or early evenings. And it's very nice, because when you spend time with nature, you realize this, there's so much of beauty in the silence, and animals are doing their own thing, and it's wonderful. I think unfortunately, I'm not a party animal, but I can make people dance. I can make people do whatever I want them to do, but I don't drink. I don't smoke. I've never done that till now because I never felt a need for it somehow. But I think it's wonderful to see each person enjoying, knowing what their moment in a party is. And I realized that this is how it is. The stereotypical people in a party, there's somebody who's, like I said, getting the drinks, somebody who's getting the house. The most important place is the house, right? So if you don't have a house and you got to wait for your in-laws to move out or your family to move out, it's going to take eternity. So people make do with what they have, and I think it's fun. I've been a part of this various WhatsApp conversations. I have a WhatsApp group, also a school group. I was studying in the school called Mount St. Mary's in Delhi, and the only conversation they have on the WhatsApp is, during this lockdown, how do we get booze? And they're all from Delhi. So I'm like, this, either I'm in some other world or I'm not able to understand what they're saying. And it's fun to listen to the conversation, because they're talking about cigarettes and they're talking about alcohol and how can we smuggle in alcohol during this lockdown. Like, typically Delhi, right? Welcome to Delhi. So, and I don't understand that. My weekends are all about, say, I write a lot. So I'm actually in the process of writing a ghost story. And I think the world needs a superhuman story right now. Not Superman or Superwoman, but a super dog. So that's something I'm working on, because I think animals will be the new superheroes for us, I believe. That's how it's going to be. So I'm working on something around that. So that takes a lot of time in the weekends or weekdays. So I follow a schedule.
What's your favorite moment during your school days? So how was Shekhar during, 10 and during your college?
I was the quietest boy in school or college, and supposedly my mom says I would never spoke for the first 3 years. And she had taken me to a doctor. The doctor said even Einstein didn't speak for the first 3 years. So that's how the doctor tried to motivate my mom. And now they say this guy cannot stop. Like, even in the family Zoom meetings, which we have every weekend, our family Zoom meetings go on for 3 hours. Everybody's talking, and I also try to put on some games there, which I try to test with them. And you know, if it works, then I can use it for the various corporate clients. But yeah, so they're like the guinea pigs for me. I hope they're not watching this. Oh, they're watching, let them watch, it's good. But for me the best moment are, you know, and I think what I'm sure, if you ask any of my teachers from school or college, they would say Shekhar was the quietest boy in school or college. He was not the kind of person who would go out and express himself. I was not the kind of guy who would be a public speaker or would talk to people. I was very quiet, but I was very observant. And I think for me, it's not the school life. College life is more exciting because college gives you some certain kind of freedom. And I studied in a boys' school. And we had a girls' school right opposite ours, which was called Loretta Convent. And we were studying in Mount St. Mary's, typically army school. So you had the march past and assembly and, you know, school life. And I was not good in studies at all. As in my 10th standard, I had scored very badly in my pre-boards. And my mom used to come for this parent-teachers meeting. And she was almost always in tears because the teachers had a lot of things to say about me because I never used to talk much and very quiet and everything. But then I think I scored the highest in history in 10th. Because one of the teachers there had said that Shekhar will create history in his own way, in a very sarcastic way. And I took that to heart and said, okay, I'll prove you wrong. And I scored the biggest marks in history. And that's when I realized, I think I like history. And though I did commerce and I did my BCom and I studied in a very interesting college in Delhi, but history is what I always loved because it's very interesting to read biographies of some very interesting people. Like, you know, there's so many of them, Mahatma Gandhi, for example, or even Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali is a big, big, big inspiration. You find a lot of videos of Muhammad Ali right now, which is circulating the internet. But I think he's been a game changer from the time he came in. So that's an inspiration.
Cool. During your college days, was it like those baggy pant days, or you know, were you from era after that?
Sorry.
Did you have baggy pants?
Baggy. Oh yes, baggy pants was the biggest thing. Baggy pants and. Baggy pants. And so we studied in army school. I studied in Mount St. Mary's, which is near Delhi, Cantic Delhi. So it's typically the boys' school. So, you know, Irish school. So you had your prayers in the morning and short hair, of course. And the advantage of my job I have is I can grow my hair as long as I want, which is not the case in school or college. And college was typically like a liberation because college is co-ed. And, you know, you get a bike and life is like set. You're like, wow. And Delhi roads is amazing. I'm talking about in the early 1990s. So Delhi is the best place for food, street food. And the Delhi culture is very different from Bangalore or Hyderabad because Delhi is in a zone of its own. Capital of India, the roads are great. And there are certain places in Delhi like Connaught Place. They can just go and have fun. So college is all about bunking college. And college is, I don't think I've ever attended college properly also because I believe... I think everybody's done that. So I've done whatever I could, watched movies, played table tennis with my friend who used to stay in JNU. So I've actually gone to JNU at that point of time and seen how JNU is. And it's a huge, huge, huge campus. And we've done all kinds of things, you know, in college. But like I said, school life is different, college life is different. But this life which I have right now, I think I enjoy this the most.
Yeah, we have compliments coming in from Vandana.
Yeah. Yeah, Vandana was, I don't know if you know this, Vandana was, Vandana is a big time lawyer. She is a law student. And Vandana was somebody who was very interesting. I worked with her in Converges. And like we all say, we all have got different moments in life. And she was the batch one of a company of a sales process, which we called CSSC. So we used to, I was a team leader for this company. Where, you know, suppose somebody like you calls in and says you want internet service. We give you internet service. We also sell you something after that. And this to the Americans, we're talking about, who had no clue where you're sitting. And we had this American name. So my name was Shakes. And you can't get more greater than that. And Vandana had an American name. And people used to call up and then they used to answer that. And they used to make big sales. So... it's not easy to make a sale and you should get a dollar per sale and everybody used to earn a lot of money at that point of time. But it was pure guts and glory because you're working night shifts, you're chasing your dreams and it was wonderful. So I was a team leader and I had a wonderful time with her. She's very intuitive. She lives in the moment and she's great fun to be with.
Cool. Your next question, your favorite girl band?
Favorite girl band? Favorite girl band, Spice Girls? Yeah, they came with a big bang at that point of time, but then they just went away after that. I think Spice Girls, yes.
Any favorite mobile game?
Any favorite?
Mobile game.
Mobile game, Road Rash.
Yeah.
Road Rash was fun, especially the way he used to kick the people around it. It reminded me of Hyderabad. Remind me of Charminar City, actually, because the traffic there is all around the place. But yeah, on a more serious note, I think Road Rash was fun. I think it was a game changer.
Rash, come back, pick up your bike, and then rash.
And then it is great. Road rage at its best, I felt. Yeah, so that was fun.
Cool. Your craziest fan story.
Craziest fan story. I get a lot of messages on Facebook Messenger. Just as we talk, 1 hour back, this gentleman called Siddharth. Mm-hmm. Siddharth, who you interviewed? Siddharth Pilli. Child prodigy, I believe. He's a very smart kid. I had interacted earlier with him for Kids Chopal, which is a teen website, and they wanted me to moderate this discussion on COVID-19. So when you're dealing with kids, it's a different energy altogether, because kids have a lot of information, a lot of energy. Everybody wants to speak. I think adults and kids are all alike right now on the Zoom platform. So this gentleman messaged me today morning saying, I'm your big fan. I saw your photographs and I think it's very interesting. So that's nice. When you get to interact with such small kids and who've got so much of energy, you can actually learn so much from them. And yeah, that's been a crazy fan story. I don't know if you can call it a fan, but it's been a moment for me too, where you get to interact with such people, because they're all interesting in their own way. Very intelligent kids. For me, age is not a criteria. Yeah, very different mindset. Nowadays, the kids are really smart, I believe.
Cool. So that finishes the rapid fire questions. Good that you interact spontaneously, and you know, we got to know the fun part and you know behind the scenes, Shekhar. So now the main question, you know, 1 minute CM. So what would you focus on if you become the chief minister for 4 years?
I think it would take me 1 minute to finish that entire oath, I believe, as a CM. But that's the first thing. The second thing is, as a CM, I would want to take care of animals first. You know, Mahatma Gandhi famously said, a country which does not take care of animals is not a great country, which is very true. I think taking care of animals is very important. Taking care of animals, taking care of dogs, taking care of all the wild animals. It's very important. Third thing is, understand the pulse of the people. And when I'm saying pulse of the people, you need to know, you cannot be 50,000 feet and know what's going on in India. India is all about the rural population. India is a diverse country. Also, it's very important to connect with people as much as you can in various forms. Could be through one-to-one sessions, one-to-many sessions. Get a good team for that. That's very important. The fourth thing is, articulate what you want and say it very clearly. I think somewhere there's a lot of information which gets lost in translation. And we in India are all armchair critics, because everybody will not like anything which comes their way, right? So as a chief minister, it's not an easy job to do. It's also about leading by example. So if you're saying something, you stand by it and make sure others follow it. And also understand that you can talk about your failures also as a CM. You can say that we have failed. Nobody's going to take that away from you. If you say that you have failed, it'll make you more vulnerable. It'll make you more open. It'll make you more relatable as a leader, as compared to somebody who's not failed, who's always putting on an image which is perfect. It can never happen. Every leader has failed. And the more you put out a honest front out there, people tend to relate to it. And I think developing a sense of humor as leaders, as chief ministers, is very important, that you can take failure in your stride. You can take criticism in your stride and convert that into an opportunity. Because everybody will not like what you do. Everybody will not like all the vegetables in town. So just convert every adversity in an opportunity. And in a place like India, for example, you got to take the people along with you. Because people will do what you want if you are able to engage them, motivate them, and inspire them. They will move mountains for you. And we've seen that happening earlier too. The Indian population, once they get swayed by this, once they get energized by this, they can do anything you want them to do. So as a leader or as a CM, I would want to engage with them as much as I can, talk to them, develop a very good team around me, which can help me in this. And also be very honest and very open with them that this is a situation, and this is what we are doing, and this is how we plan to fight it out. Rather than putting on an act and, you know, not coming out with correct information, and which leads to a lot of rumor mongering, which is what is happening right now.
Well said. I really like that point, Shekhar, that, you know, they should have guts to say that, yeah, hey, these projects which we plan, 8 went good, 2 we couldn't finish, you know, it's work in progress, or, you know, we're not planning to do it. I think they need to do that and, you know, honestly come out with that thing and, you know, take people along with them. So cool. Thanks. Thanks for these inputs and thanks for connecting today. Thanks for taking time out. So, yeah,
I have a question for you. Don't worry, I'm not putting you on the spot or something. What would you do as a PM? Sorry, as a president. So forget that. What would you do right now if you're the president of US?
Of US?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I'll start accepting the mistakes and I would start doing the same thing what you mentioned, you know, saying that just be with people, you know, take care of others. Just those tweets and all that.
And set that ego aside. No? I think most important is ego. I think
I am the president of
the most powerful country in the world. That entire thing is, you're right.
Yeah, I will take all the mayors because I see a lot of differences between the mayors, and there's a big, you know, Mexican wall is between the mayors and it was basically break that.
They need a Mexican wave right now.
Make any sense.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, sir. I think we are all on the same track. And you spoke so much of, I think it's so nice connecting with you, talking to you. You're such a pleasant man. And I was very spontaneous, which I am. And I hope, I think all the viewers understood what we were trying to say, but it was great fun connecting with you.
Thank you so much. If you are here in Hyderabad or I visit Bangalore, we'll definitely...
We should definitely catch up.
We'll have to be a part of your event. And I'll 100%. Also... your events which are happening live now. So friends, please do join. Follow Shekhar. I'll share his links.
Thank you so much.
Encourage the artist. It is very difficult to make somebody laugh, stand on that particular stage and, you know, create entertainment that would entertain the other audience. So he's doing a great job. So let's
thank you so much.
Follow him and then, you know, praise him, whatever he is doing.
Thank you. Ravi, I want to end with a note. So, you know, I mentioned it earlier that my biggest inspiration has been Muhammad Ali and also my dog Sunshine, who's sleeping right now as we talk. She's making good use of her time. So Muhammad Ali, there's an Amazon special on Muhammad Ali by his opponents, what they liked about Muhammad Ali, because Muhammad Ali was one of the first boxers in the field of sports who used poetry to intimidate his opponents. So his press conferences were magic. Because the man could, what Austin talks about mental disintegration, or where we are trying to polarize the opponent, he used to do that in the press conferences, where he will say, float like a butterfly, buzz like a bee, you know, float like a butterfly, and various things. He used to make sure everything rhymes, and he was a great exponent of racism, and of the fact that he was very clear about what he wanted as a sportsperson, as an ambassador. So his opponents spoke about him in an Amazon special, which is very interesting because they spoke about his entire strategy, about how he used to intimidate them before a game. There was a very famous tournament called Rumble in the Jungle, which happened somewhere in Africa with George Foreman. And they used to say his entire strategy was because he was built like a machine. First 10 rounds, they would keep beating him and he would just stay there like that. After 10 rounds, they would get tired and then he would start hitting back. So that's a very, you know, I like that philosophy a lot. I like that entire motto a lot because it meant that he was very strong, very persistent. And even if they were hitting him for 10 rounds, he knew that he could get back and rise. That's exactly what we need to do right now as we talk, because we don't know how the future is going to hold in terms of the pandemic. It might grow, it might go down, nobody knows it. And the only way to deal with it is to stay calm and let the storm pass, because once the storm passes, there'll be a silver lining in each cloud. And if you're in Bangalore, it's only cloudy, so it's good.
Cool. Keep rocking, Shekhar. So we have.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, everybody, for listening in and watching in. I think it's wonderful. And like I always say, we are all very interesting stories. Make it count.
Cool. Thank you, Shekhar. Have a great
day. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And let's watch up for more inspiring people who are joining this particular show. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.